My name is Muhammad.
I'm Dean.
Hi, my name is Teja.
My name is Crystal.
Hi, I'm Francis Ming, and I'm on a working title for 2014. We all do have a passion for what we want to do, but we're realising that there are so many different ideas that come about.
We were all in the round table talking about ideas. It's just really inspiring.
This is like a coconut chutney and usually has some kind of either potato or some kind of filling inside of it.
I need it now.
I'm blinded. I'm hungry. And I'm excited.
So back to 50. So press the zoom button.
Yep.
Now use that wheel. It's focused.
Okay. Oh, that's cool.
If it flashes.
And zoom is this bit, yeah?
Yeah. Okay. That's cool.
I really wanted to learn the filmmaking all the time. And it was something that I was interested in since I was a kid, you know, I was young. So I came here, and then when I joined it, I really, really liked it because the first day I came here, I just knew it that this was the right people because the way they explained it and the way it was scheduled and the program that was scheduled and what we were doing, it was like really clear.
And channel one is boom, which needs phantom, so we say yes.
I feel like the progress of it, it was something that, you know, we expect something and it was breaking that expectations because it actually taught me what I wanted to learn. And it actually taught it very, in a way that I could understand it better, and it was very clear. And now, in my third week, we're already up to where, like, we are already having ideas about filmmaking and making a short film. So it's not like, you know, confusing to me as it was before, like, how do you, you know, get the cameras, how do you set up sound? It was nice, like, very clear. I know what I have to do, and there's still more weeks left, so I think I can improve myself a bit more with this program.
And did you get anything to eat?
No, nothing.
We had a few issues with the lighting and that kind of stuff, but I think we worked it out in the end. One of the cameras ran out of battery halfway through, we had to swap camera, so in the end, I'm glad everything kind of worked out.
Sorry.
Happy, excited. I don't know, really.
My feelings right now would be surprise, anticipation, anxiety.
I decided to wear a singlet, and this ended up being the outcome, and this ended up being the outcome.
Ouch.
I'm really happy, it's enjoyable, and it's fantastic.
Today's interview was really amazing, you know, it was really inspiring. I just like the best thing about documentaries is that whenever you go and meet people, you just feel like you just learn something new, and that's the best part, you know, you just get inspired and you just want to do something with your life as well, you know, instead of just staying back and, you know, this is really inspiring stuff. I just hope that we'll get to meet more people like this. That's the best part about this, actually.
Hi, my name is Harry. I'm enjoying with this team. I'm very happy to work with them.
I'm a camera virgin, never done it before. one of our first setups, so it obviously takes a little bit longer than you'd like if we were, you know, really streamlined, but everything's been fantastic.
Just we need to start it and just go.
That's a wrap.
Muhammad is really a nice guy, so she arranged so many things. Sorry. I want to start it again.
Yeah, start again, because you said she.
She, yeah, that's what I realized.
Our film is about Shabnam, which is a girl. Sorry, I want to start it again. No. Ah. Hello, we are from Working Title 2014. My name is Lucky.
My name is Muhammad. We are working on a documentary movie about an Afghan girl. She's a kind of girl that broken in or overcome some limitations or some culture norms. We are in Afghan community. Generally, there are some things that not accepted that the girls doing that, especially sports like karate or some martial arts, where Shabnam has broken this culture norm, crossed some of the boundaries with supporting of her family.
This guy is always piss me off, man.
He's my wife.
He's talking. And I was trying to keep her down, but she's like trying to keep her up. But it's documentary, it's not like...
My name is Shabnam Safa. I'm 20 years old. I was born in Afghanistan and my family moved to Pakistan when I was very young to flee war and persecution in Afghanistan. So I grew up as an Afghan refugee in Pakistan.
In May 2009, I and my family, we came to Australia and I started school from year 9. I graduated school in 2012 and I started my university life as a biomedical science and chemical engineering student, but I'm now currently undertaking a Bachelor's of Global Arts majoring in International Studies at Monash University. Living as an Afghan refugee in Pakistan, you would be lucky, a girl would be lucky if she even got a chance to complete her education, and back there I was really, really focused on my educational goals.
I started karate with Unsukai Karate in 2011 and I love it. The passion motivates me to teach it to younger kids as well, so I became an assistant instructor. I would train 3 to 4 times a week and I've competed and won at regional, state and national level championships, and I managed to achieve my black belt in July 2013.
If the girls, they are not given the same rights as the boys, if the girls been discouraged that, you know, why do you want to go study? You know, when you grow young, when you become an adult, you're going to your husband's house. Why do you want to go to play sports? This doesn't meant for girls. It's meant only for the boys. And especially tell the girls, you should stay home. You should not drive a car. You should not go participate in Australian way of life. That's not the way to go about it.
My father was already hearing a lot from the community outside for letting his wife work outside and let her daughter study, because most of the times you would only get up to say year 10 or year 11 and the girl would be made to stay at home or just do the housework or get married, raise kids. Looking at their smiling faces, you wouldn't even tell what's hidden behind the smiles and what they have seen throughout their life. And I just want to make sure that if they haven't had a peaceful and a comfortable life before, I could help or I could give that to them now so they could have like at least a better second half of their life.
کسی که موانی پیشرفت خود اوسم کده او زیاد پیشرفت داشته اما چی تضاد خود بسیار تانسته خوب حل کنه با او خاطر ما هم تضاد در فامیل خود حل کردیم و مانع پیشرفت چی شبنم نشودیم. میگیم که شما به نسل‌های آینده تعلق دارین و خودتان میتونین که خوبتر مسائل مشکلاتتان حل کنین. نه ما، به ما مربوط نشوین و خودتان میتونین خوب پیشرفت کنین، میتونین که سپورت کنین، میتونین که یونیورسیتی بخونین، میتونین که هر کار را که به امو خوبی تان است او را باید اختیار کنین.
فقط رکتبال شبنم دیده یا گرفته به خود او که تمامش پشت کار یا امت خود شبنم بوده که با مو اعتماد به نفس که خودش داشته یا با مو آرزویی که داشته یا امو خیال یا فکر که در فکرش بوده و تلاش که داشته با مو رسیده. و در قدم دوم ادمن یک پشتیوانه یا سپورت فامیل خدا میخواست که در اینجا پشتیوانه پدرش و از خود ما و فامیل ما بوده. یعنی رسیدن شبنم به این مرحله زیادتر مربوط خودش بوده و یک فامیل مانع یا صدرایش نشده، فقط راهنمایی کردیمش و همکار بودیم امرایش با وجود از اینکه مشکلات خود داشته، ولی تانستیم یاری برسانیمش که برسه به می جایا.
I believe that that's not what many other Afghan girls or girls from a stricter cultural background experience as well. I think that they need to be encouraged a little more through their family, through their community, and they need to make sure that they have got that confidence, because sometimes there are times when they wouldn't even have the confidence to bring up the question. So I would say have a little bit more faith and if the boys can do it, you can do it too.
فرق بچه و دختر که یعنی برای بچه آزادی های رو بتن و برای دختر و آزادی ها رو سلب کنن. یه چیز باید نباشه. بخاطر از اینکه حق آزادی یا آزاد بودن انسان مربوط دختر و بچه است. این نیست که ما برای دختر مدود بسازیم و برای بچه آزادی های خود آزادی هایش برش بدیم. باید امو آزادی رو که برای بچه در نظر میگیریم برای دختر هم بدیم تا بتانه او با مو آرزو یا با مو هدفی که داره برسه. و در جامعه افغانستان ما یا در کمیونیتی ما که است، بدون پشتیبانی فامیل یک دختر نمیتونه که با مو جایی که میخواد با مقامی که میخواد برسه.
شبنم is a role model to the rest of the community. The rest of the community can follow her lead, you know, to be, you know, the best as they can be. They can exceed, exceed the expectation of, status quo. Exceed the expectation of people who says, no, you can't do this, you can't do that. Why? Because you are a woman, and woman gender is inferior. That's not on.
Has become a bit of a cultural norm that girls should only stick to education. They should really pursue their educational goals. There's hardly been any attention paid to extracurricular activities, particularly sport. So I'd say just go and follow on your passion for any type of sport you have, or for any type of arts, music, dance, whatever it is, just follow it. Break those cultural norms, because somebody has to.
My name is Muhammad.
I'm Dean.
Hi, my name is Teja.
My name is Crystal.
Hi, I'm Frances Ming, and I'm on working title for do have a passion for what we want to do, but we're realising that there are so many different ideas that come about.
She is part.
We were all in the round table talking about ideas. It's just really inspiring.
This is like a coconut chutney, and usually has some kind of either potato or some kind of filling inside of it.
I need it now.
I'm blinded. I'm hungry. And I'm excited.
So back to 50. So press the zoom button.
Yep.
Yep. Now use that wheel. It's focused.
Okay. Oh, that's cool.
If it flashes. And zoom is this bit, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's cool.
I really wanted to learn the filmmaking all the time, and it was something that I was interested in since I was a kid, you know, I was young. So I came here, and then when I joined it, I really liked it because the first day I came here, I just knew it that this was the right people, because the way they explained it and the way it was scheduled and the program that was scheduled and what we were doing, it was like really clear.
And channel one is boom, which needs phantom, so we say yes.
I feel like the progress of it was really, it is something that, you know, we expect something and it was breaking that expectations, because it actually taught me what I wanted to learn, and it actually taught it very in a way that I could understand it better, and it was very clear. And now in my third week, we're already up to where like we are already having ideas about filmmaking and making a short film. So it's not like, you know, confusing to me as it was before, like how do you, you know, get the cameras, how do you set up sound. It was nice, like very clear. I know what I have to do. And there's still more weeks left, so I think I can improve myself a bit more with this program.
Issues with lighting and that kind of stuff, but I think we worked it out in the end. One of the cameras ran out of battery halfway through, we had to swap camera, so in the end, I'm glad everything kind of worked out.
Sorry!
Happy, excited, I don't know, really.
My feelings right now would be surprise. Anticipation, anxiety.
I decided to wear a singlet, and this ended up being the outcome, and this ended up being the outcome.
Ouch.
Come on. I'm really happy, it's enjoyable, and this is fantastic.
Today's interview was really amazing, you know? It was really inspiring. I just like the best thing about documentaries is that whenever you go and meet people, you just feel like you just learn something new, and that's the best part, you know, you just get inspired and you just want to do something with your life as well, you know, instead of just staying back. And you know, this is really inspiring stuff. I just hope that we'll get to meet more people like this. That's the best part about this, actually.
Hi, my name is Harry. I'm enjoying with this team. I'm very happy to work with them.
I'm a camera virgin, never done it before.
It's one of our first setups, so obviously it takes a little bit longer than you'd like if we were, you know, really streamlined, but everything's been fantastic.
It's really a piece of cake, just spin it to the side and just go.
That's a wrap. Why?
Hi, my name is Billy.
I'm Crystal.
Hi, I'm Dean, and this is Melanie, who couldn't be here today.
My name is Melanie. Joined this working title because I believed it was a good experience. I really want to do this in the future.
Our documentary is about esports in Australia, following a competitive League of Legends team and other pioneers in the underdeveloped gaming industry.
For me, one of the biggest things I love about the gaming community is just the excitement and the exuberance. I mean, for a lot of us, like, gaming becomes your hobby. It's what you do with your spare time. It's what you do with your fun time. So there's just a ton of passion about that. And there's a ton of content that just comes out of there between, like, you know, gaming art and YouTube channels. I mean, like, it's a phenomenon. It's something that, it's a culture to belong to, and it's a worldwide culture. Like gaming is a culture. It's something that you can belong to no matter, you know, where you were born or how you got there.
I would describe League of Legends as, for example, running a business. And to have a successful business, you need to have teamwork, cooperation, and communication to run a successful business. And, you know, it just goes to the same as the game. That's how you win.
You got five players, and the other team has five players, and you're basically just trying to outplay the other team. To go professional in League of Legends would absolutely be the best career possible for me at this point in time.
It's actually a pretty sad story. I got in a car accident and I was unable to walk for a couple of months. So I started picking up League from there, and I started playing in Season 3 halfway through. My friend recommended me to play the game since I wasn't able to do anything else at that time. So I got into it through that way.
League of Legends, to me, is a way of life. It's something I would like to get myself into. Maybe not as professional scene, but involved in esports, because I would like to see the growth in Australia.
League of Legends has affected my life through allowing me to look at gaming as something other than a hobby, because my goal in League of Legends is to become a professional player. And since I get to see it from a different perspective, I treat it a lot more serious, and yeah, it's a bigger part of my life.
How Team Equalizer became created, it was a local LAN at Guff Cafe, and I just got a group of my friends, like, hey guys, come play this local tournament. There's a few good prizes. We lost the grand final to a team that had a gaming house, and they've been together for 2 years. We did very well against them. We were surprised with ourselves. We're like, hang on guys, look how good we've done, like, so far.
I came to join Team Equalizer from my mate Jordan, EQ Phage. We met on the NA server in a random game, and we joined a Skype call, and I saw a Skype picture. It was of Pow, a club. And I'm like, mate, are you from Werribee? Like, oh yeah, mate. And that's how we got to know each other. Completely random game. And yeah, he's like, oh, do you want to join team for a competition for Guff? I'm like, oh yeah, sure, let's go. And yeah, we did pretty well. We formed the team, and bang, we're all mates.
Well, I knew the mid laner, which is EQ Matrix, and from him I met these other guys, and because they were doing like a local tournament, which was at Guff here, yeah, so we did the tournament through that way, and then that's how I got to know Team EQ.
In terms of the looks of games, I mean, games are just exciting. They're fun to watch. I mean, like, you know, long before there was esports, there was a bunch of, you know, friends sitting down on the couch just having a blast playing these kind of games. So it completely makes sense that, you know, you'd want to take that experience and blow it out to everyone.
Personally, I feel that esports in Australia is kind of lacking compared to the other countries. For example, there's not many good professional teams out right now that represent Oceanic as a whole region compared to North America or even the Koreans who just dominate everyone.
It's crazy, it's becoming a spectator sport. Like, Korea last finals, I'm pretty sure, filled out almost the whole stadium, like 300,000 people, which is crazy. And people don't realise that. That's what I'm saying. Like, people don't recognise that.
My family felt that me putting so much time into a computer game at first was a waste and that I should focus my energy in something more productive. But when they finally realised that it was meant something serious to me and that I wanted to make a career out of it, I think they're finally realising that this is a serious thing and they can go somewhere.
Well, my parents, don't worry about them. I just got my cousins, that's all I need.
My brother supports me the most with League of Legends. I've showed him many things, such as the live Twitch streams that show all the people watching. Some of the things I do in the game, he just goes, how did you do that? Your reaction time improved as a player that much that I can see you as being one of the best in Oceanic.
I would honestly would throw my job in to do a full-time law career. Like, my parents may not agree with that. I would love to show them that it actually is a positive future and you can make money off this and it is going to be well recognised.
I was doing nursing until I got into the car accident and I was unable to go to uni anymore. So I did my placement at uni this year and then I stopped that. And so in the next couple of years, hopefully, maybe I'll be working in a career in the Navy, so yeah.
When I don't play League of Legends, I work with children. I'm a childcare educator. Other than that, I like to keep fit. I eat a lot of food. And yeah, I just think about League of Legends and what I can do to improve, like in my spare time. I know it's a bit, you know, but I like to constantly think about it.
So my goal as a player and a lover of video games is to expand esports in Australia. I love gaming, everyone loves gaming, you can't deny it. And it's about time that we just got some kind of scene going in Australia where people could come out, play games for a living and do what they're good at. People in Australia get the chance, get the opportunity to play professional level gaming, and that's it. I mean, that's me, that's why I'm here, that's why I'm running this tournament. That's the only thought process that I have on this tournament.
The most unique part of being in a league team is that it'll eventually get down to that crucial situation, and it's either make or break at one point, and in the end it comes down to the communication between the team and the synergy that if the team follows up on what your next plan of action is.
Being Australia is very behind the world, especially compared to like Korea, North America, Europe. I reckon Australia with the national broadband, once that goes around, it should boost up. But generally, it's the companies not really backing a lot of teams. We can't really stream as well like America. Like, people actually make a living off streaming.
I feel that esports in Australia is such a growing thing that currently it is underrated and not considered a viable option for people trying to go professional. I think that if more companies realise that professional teams can advertise their products and then if they can start supporting teams in a better, more secure fashion, I feel like esports could boom a lot in Australia, and with that we could move on to like international tournaments and stuff.
I honestly believe Australia can compete in international level league. If they dedicate themselves enough, they can pretty much beat a lot of high, well-known teams. But I honestly believe the dedication is lacking because people have to study, people have to, like, there's no infrastructure to actually keep it a full-time job like in other countries.
You know, it's what we want. As growing up, we always want to do what we love, you know, as a job. And what better than to play games for a job, you know what I mean? So we need esports in Australia. And that's my main goal out of this whole tournament.
I've actually asked them, oh, do you play League of Legends? Like, oh yeah. But they don't know what I'm talking about, so.
League is life, the end.
My name is Muhammad.
I'm Dean.
Hi, my name is Teja.
My name is Crystal.
Hi, I'm Frances Ming, and I'm on working title for 2014. Do have a passion for what we want to do, but we're realizing that there are so many different ideas that come about.
She sort of is part.
We were all in the round table talking about ideas. It's just really inspiring.
This is like a coconut chutney and usually has some kind of either potato or some kind of filling inside of it.
I need it now.
I'm blinded. I'm hungry. And I'm excited.
So back to 50. So press the zoom button.
Yep.
Now use that wheel. It's focused.
Okay. Oh, that's cool.
If it flashes,
and zoom is this bit, yeah?
Yeah.
I really wanted to learn the filmmaking all the time, and it was something that I was interested in since I was a kid, you know, I was young. So I came here, and then when I joined it, I really, really liked it because the first day I came here, I just knew it that this was the right people because the way they explained it and the way it was scheduled and the program that was scheduled and what we were doing, it was like really clear.
And channel one is boom, which needs phantom, so we say yes.
I feel like the progress of it was really, it is something that, you know, we expect something and it was breaking that expectations because it actually taught me what I wanted to learn and it actually taught it very in a way that I could understand it better and it was very clear. And now in my third week, we're already up to where like we are already having ideas about filmmaking and making a short film. So it's not like, you know, confusing to me as it was before, like how do you, you know, get the cameras, how do you set up sound? It was nice, like very clear. I know what I have to do. And there's still more weeks left, so I think I can improve myself a bit more with this program.
Issues with the lighting and that kind of stuff, but I think we worked it out in the end. One of the cameras ran out of battery halfway through, we had to swap camera, so in the end, I'm glad everything kind of worked out.
Sorry.
Happy, excited, I don't know, really.
My feelings right now would be surprise. Anticipation, anxiety.
I decided to wear a singlet, and this ended up being the outcome, and this ended up being the outcome.
Ouch.
Come on. I'm really happy, it's enjoyable, and it's fantastic.
Today's interview was really amazing, you know, it was really inspiring. I just like, the best thing about documentaries is that whenever you go and meet people, you just feel like you just learn something new. And that's the best part, you know, you just get inspired and you just want to do something with your life as well, you know, instead of just staying back and, you know, it's really inspiring stuff. I just hope that we'll get to meet more people like this. That's the best part about this, actually.
Hi, my name is Harry. I'm enjoying with this team. I'm very happy to work with them.
I'm a camera virgin, never done it before.
just one of our first setups, so obviously it takes a little bit longer than you'd like if we were, you know, really streamlined, but everything's been fantastic.
To really piss off, you just we need to start it and just go.
In early 1980s, the Bhutanese government expelled 1/6 of the population of the Bhutan. They are forced to seek refugee camp, where they have to spend 18 years of miserable life in refugee camp. So I decided to do the documentary regarding my own background and my people, my true story of refugee. Basically, the documentary will be in regard to the story of Bhutanese refugee, starting from the Bhutan till coming to Australia.
Hi, we are the part of Working Title 2014. Our film is about the Bhutanese refugee. I hope you will enjoy the film.
Bhutan is about as far away from Australia as you can get. Tiny Himalayan kingdom sandwiched between India and China. It looks idyllic, beautiful, clean and peaceful. But not for Nepali ethnic Bhutanese. Kedar Achari was 4 years old when he fled, hitching a truck ride through India to Nepal and to a UN refugee camp where the young Kedar would spend the next 20 years.
I was born in Bhutan, a small country on the laps of the Asian continent. When I was 4 years old, I, along with all my family members, was evicted from my motherland, Bhutan.
Nearly two decades ago, Bhutan began expelling its Nepali ethnic residents. It lost 1/6 of its population. They were expelled 20 years ago from their country. Over 100,000 went to Nepal and lived in refugee camps ever since. Home to over 100,000 people, the camp had no clean water and poor education services. There was not enough food and inadequate healthcare. Today, no resolution in the crisis and not even one refugee allowed to return. Instead, they are languished for 20 years of miserable life in refugee camps. There was simply no future and hope there. In 2007, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugee, the UNHCR, passed the initiative allowing the nationless citizens to immigrate to their new home. Since that time, more than 100,000 have resettled to third countries, including Australia. Around 4,500 have already resettled in Australia through humanitarian program.
The day I landed in Australia was the happiest day in my life, though I was full of sorrows in my head and heart as I left all my friends and relatives.
Parsu Sharma Lutel is another Bhutanese success story. Parsu also resettled in Melbourne, Australia, and has been very active in the community.
I'm from Bhutan. I came to Australia 14 years ago. I came with my wife and two children, and one of my daughters born here in Australia.
Mitra Adhikari, a Bhutanese priest, came to Australia in 2011. He begins his day by worshipping God.
Mero naam Mitra Adhikari ho. Puri mulukko Jhapa antargat Timai shibir ma 18 barsha samma basobaso gariyo. त्यही बसोबासो गर्ने क्रममा कहिले यसरी नै भगवानको सेवा पूजा आफ्नो धर्म संस्कार संस्कृतिलाई बचाउने क्रममा यसरी नै आफ्नो जीवनलाई निरन्तर लगाइरह्यो भने कहिले क्याम्प अन्तर्गत केही मात्रामा स्कुलहरू पनि थिए र नेपाली शिक्षकको रूपमा पनि आबद्ध भइयो र नेपाली भाषालाई पनि अलिकति ज्ञानार्जन गराउने बाटामा पनि लागियो म पूर्वी मुलुकको भुटानबाट यस अस्ट्रेलियामा 2011 फर्स्ट मार्चमा आइपुगेको हुँ
Living in a multicultural nation, both Hindu and Buddhist people are happy to perform their rituals and culture with full rights and dignity.
मेरो नाम चाहिँ खासै यता मानवीर भनिन्छ तर मलाई लामा गुरुजीले राखिदिनु भएको नाम चाहिँ दावा हो म वर्षको उमेरदेखि लामा पढ्नु प्रवेश गरियो
Buddhist community's involvement in cultural activities Barely 2 years old in the country, in 2010, Victoria celebrates the Premier's Gala Dinner in the Crown Casino, where 1,400 leaders, ministers, VIPs attend. And in 2010, Bhutanese community was given opportunity, and our community had performed Bhutanese and Nepali dance. This has given us an opportunity to introduce a country barely 2 years old in Australia. So that's one. After that, the preservation of culture, language and tradition and different religious ceremonies are the integral part of Bhutanese society, particularly the middle age and above. Without that, that's very difficult for Bhutanese. And as three generations of Bhutanese live in one house, and cultural preservation is a very key point to the Bhutanese parents.
The Australian Bhutanese community brings a rich cultural heritage with them, adding more spice to the Australian culture. Life in Australia is challenging for Bhutanese people, as they have to master a new language, environment, and new rules and regulations. Even with all these challenges, most Bhutanese refugees do not regret moving out of the camps. When it comes to cultural celebrations and festivals, young and old Bhutanese come together in harmony and participate actively. This participation reflects the vibrancy and cohesion of the barely four-year-old Bhutanese community in Australia. Most Bhutanese seniors stay connected to the community through weekly cultural activities such as singing and chanting. Despite years of hardship in refugee camps, Bhutanese refugees remain positive in their new country. Social and religious activities allow them to maintain their culture while successfully adapting to a new one.
My name is Muhammad.
I'm Dean.
Hi, my name is Teja.
My name is Crystal.
Hi, I'm Frances Ming, and I'm on a working title for 2014. Do have a passion for what we want to do, but we're realizing that there are so many different ideas that come about.
She is part.
We were all in the round table talking about ideas. It's just really inspiring.
This is like a coconut chutney and usually has some kind of either potato or some kind of filling inside of it.
I need it now. I'm blinded. I'm hungry. And I'm excited.
So back to 50. So press the zoom button.
Yep.
Now use that wheel. It's focused.
Okay. Oh, that's cool.
If it flashes,
and zoom is this bit, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. That's cool.
I really wanted to learn the filmmaking all the time, and it was something that I was interested in since I was a kid, you know, I was young. So I came here, and then when I joined it, I really liked it because the first day I came here, I just knew it that this was the right people because the way they explained it and the way it was scheduled and the program that was scheduled and what we were doing, it was like really clear.
And channel one is boom, which needs phantom, so we say yes.
I feel like the progress of it was really, it is something that, you know, we expect something and it was breaking that expectations because it actually taught me what I wanted to learn and it actually taught it very in a way that I could understand it better and it was very clear. And now in my third week, we're already up to where like we are already having ideas about filmmaking and making a short film. So it's not like, you know, confusing to me as it was before, like how do you, you know, get the cameras, how do you set up sound? It was nice, like very clear. I know what I have to do. And there's still more weeks left, so I think I can improve myself a bit more with this program.
Issues with lighting and that kind of stuff, but I think we worked it out in the end. One of the cameras ran out of battery halfway through, we had to swap camera, so in the end, I'm glad everything kind of worked out.
Sorry.
Happy, excited, I don't know, really.
My feelings right now would be surprise. Anticipation, anxiety.
I decided to wear a singlet, and this ended up being the outcome, and this ended up being the outcome.
Ouch. I'm really happy, it's enjoyable, and it's fantastic.
Today's interview was really amazing, you know, it was really inspiring. I just like, the best thing about documentaries is that whenever you go and meet people, you just feel like you just learn something new. And that's the best part, you know, you just get inspired and you just want to do something with your life as well, you know, instead of just staying back and, you know, it's really inspiring stuff. I just hope that we'll get to meet more people like this. That's the best part about this, actually.
Hi, my name is Harry. I'm enjoying with this team. I'm very happy to work with them.
I'm a camera virgin, never done it before.
It's one of our first setups, so it obviously takes a little bit longer than you'd like if we were, you know, really streamlined, but everything's been fantastic.
It's really a piece of it. Just we need to start it and just go.
Welcome! We were very much privileged to interview Dennis Grace from the Afrofeast African Food Truck.
Initially, we only wanted to capture the colourful truck and the food that it brought to Melbourne.
We ended up being pleasantly surprised to find out about the man behind the food.
Making this documentary has been really a great experience for all of us, and I hope you all enjoy it.
My food truck is called Afrofeast. Basically defines the kind of food that I do. Afrofeast means African food, basically, African feast.
Today, we just came to shop. I'm gonna get the meat today. After here, I'll go and get the veggies. And then after that, I'll go and get the spices. So three things for me today. After that, going home.
You see all of these food trucks, you see burgers, you see hamburgers, you see Mexican, but there was totally nothing African. So how do they know about African if they don't see it around? So I thought that is a cool idea. I thought that is worth venturing.
If I had a lot of events, this can't take me long. It's just 30 kilos, I cook twice and it's gone.
We're dishing out something that is different. We're basically doing Pan-African street foods. Right now, we're doing mainly South African. We're doing East African. We have what is called the bunny chow, lamb curry in hollowed out bread. We also have the boerewors. Boerewors is South African sausage, which is quite delicious. And we had long lines of people just coming back to have a taste of the sausages. And then from East Africa, we prepare the Zanzibar pilau. People love it, it smells really nice. It's fried rice together with beef and it's amazing. I was born in the 70s in a country called Uganda in Africa. I was born in a small town called Jinja. Amin was a dictator in Uganda. He was toppled in 1979. So we ran away and went to the village for the first time. I started experiencing life in the village. For me, that was the time that I learned a lot of things. And I learned that life is not just very easy. You have to work very hard for yourself. 89, I left the village when I was about 16 years. My dad, being a military officer, was very tough in most cases. He used to bash us a lot for so many years. and that happens every day, like every week. So I thought that was really too much for me. I thought I would go and wear coats and start fending for myself. But of course, in the streets, life is not as smooth as you think. Every time you're netted, captured by the police, they're always swooping on you. They take you to the police station, then you're out again. It's a process that is kind of cyclical. So the Christmas of 1989, I actually spent it in prison. And that was my very first Christmas in prison, away from my family at the age of 16. It's terrible. You dig until this peels off. Actually, at one point in time, my palms were peeling off. They're just red, you know, and the blood was coming out. But you're being flogged on the back all of the time you're digging. One lesson that I learned from that prison, and the one lesson that I appreciate my dad, was taking me through tough life. And now I use that experience to survive. I left Uganda basically to go and volunteer. I love volunteering. I had been a local volunteer and I love helping people. I had been a product of help. If people hadn't helped me along the way, I wouldn't be where I am. One of the proverbs in Uganda says, "Omumpi wakuma wakwata," where the short person reaches is where they can touch. That is kind of a literal translation. That means that right now I can only reach so far, so I can only run a food truck. If I had more money, probably would open up food trucks all over Australia. When I first came in Australia, I used to live with my in-laws, and my in-laws used to serve very European food, that soup, sandwiches for dinner. So this kind of food was very totally new to me, and I thought they were just snacks, so they're gonna serve something more heavy. But now, of course, after staying in Australia, I can make my own sandwich. Melbourne is a multicultural city. We have different people here. You just walk in the city, you see different people. You don't even know how they came here. It has diverse people, it has diverse cultures, it has diverse food. In that way, it also helps us to share our stories, to share our identity, to share our culture, to express ourselves and let them know that we are part of the Australian landscape now. My life is juggling between my business and the community organization that I support in Uganda, and of course, my family. It's a little bit intense, but I love it. Are you ready, King of Simon? Ricky.